So first of all, the term robotic process automation, right? So what does mean this robotic process automation? So there are many automations that are existing in the real world, like even in the IT automations that are available, like Selenium or UFT, you must have been heard about this, right? So even after having those kinds of tools, why we still need to go for robotic process automation? It is really required, or what is it that we are not able to accomplish with the existing tools? So if we see the terminology robotic process automation, these are two. First is robotic and second one is process automation, right? So whatever we are talking here in robot RPA, right, we are going to talk about the process automation. So there are different types of automation. If we consider the Selenium automation or UFT automations, those are testing tool automations, right? So if there is a website and they wanted to check all the different like different defects or different issues with the website, right? Then we can actually write those scripts wherein we can actually use the Selenium scripts, and then we'll be able to find the results that are having issues with that particular website using the automation testing tools, right? But currently, whatever we are talking about, this is process automation tools. These are not something related to testing automation. So what is difference between the process automation? So let us see what is process automation first. So when I say process automation, right? So process automation is like, if let us say I have a process. So if I consider one organization, let us consider an organization, there is a BPO organization. Okay, so there is an organization, let us say the BPO organization name is one. Okay, BPO one. So in this BPO organization, so let us consider there is a project. For that particular project, there are 30 employees. Okay, so 30 employees are working for a basic task. Actually, if it is a BPO organization, right, so it will be basically all the tasks will be repetitive tasks, right? It's like whatever the task that they do, it will be almost same thing, right? It will be like maybe data filling tasks, or maybe some kind of tasks which is not involved, like coding or many things that are not involved, right? So mostly all the tasks are repetitive tasks, right? So if we take an example wherein this BPO organization one, they are having 30 employees. So their day in day out task is to, let us say the client has some 50 or 60 servers. Okay, so these 60 servers, they are monitoring the servers, right? So how they are monitoring? So there is a web application wherein there is some kind of portal wherein they actually logging in the web portal. Okay, so they are logging into the web portal and then checking the statuses of the servers that are running, right? If let us say the server status is running or completed, right? So that means it is good. It is still good. They don't need to worry about it, right? So these statuses are good statuses, correct? If let us say there is a server with failed or blocked, right? If this is the server status that they are seeing, they have to report it immediately, right? If the server is failed or blocked by something else, right, they have to resolve that issue, where exactly that particular issue is there, correct? So what they will do, they will raise an incident, correct? So they will raise an incident using ServiceNow or tickets or whatever it is. There are different tools that we can use for raising the incidents, correct? So they will raise an incident, let us say P1, P2, whatever incident priority they wanted to put, right? So then they will send it in an email also to the client group. Let us say there is a business group, right? So who's actually related with this particular servers, right? So they will be also sending an email stating that we got this so and so error, so and so server got failed, right? So generally they will be having some SLAs as well, right? So in this particular SLA, they had to fix that issue, right? So if we consider this example, these 30 employees, so they are actually working in three different shifts. So as it is a BPO organization, they have to support 24 by 7. right? So if we consider there are 30 people, right? Let us say 10 people per shift, right? 10 employees per shift. So for three different shifts, we are having 30 employees, right? So all these 30 employees day in, day out task is this one. So these servers, they are checking whether it is good or whether it is failed or blocked, right? If it is failed, then they have to raise an incident. They have, once the incident is raised, they have to send it an email, right? If we consider this entire thing, right, we call this as a process, right? So this is a process for us. If I wanted to automate this particular process, entire process, when I talk about the process automation, I'm going to talk about the entire process automation. It's not like I will be only automating one web application that is available, or it's not only one application. It is, when I say process, it is from the start till the end. So whatever they are logging in, how they are logging in, each and everything will be considered in the process. We are talking about, so how many applications that we are dealing here? Hello.
Yeah.
So in this example that we are talking about, right? So how many applications that we are dealing?
Rather than application, I can see only a process, right? Maybe one application, a BPO.
Yeah. So first one is a web application. There we are. After then there are an incident, right? Incident is raised in a ServiceNow portal. Let us assume there is a ServiceNow portal. So that is also a web application, correct?
Yeah.
So two applications. And then once the ticket is raised, they're also sending it in an email, correct? Which is Outlook, yeah. Let us consider it as a desktop application. Right? So if you see here, there are totally three different applications that are involved to complete this particular process, correct? So in order to accomplish this process, first of all, logging into this web application, checking the status. If the status is failed, then raising the ticket, then using an Outlook to send it an email, right? So it's not like I will be only automating one web application. I have to automate the entire process. First logging into that web application, then we have to connect to the second ServiceNow portal. From there, we have to connect to the third Outlook application. So that is the reason the robotic process automation is called as process automation. It's not like we are going to automate one application. Unlike if we see Selenium, right? If I wanted to automate, it will be only for one application. One web application, we'll be able to automate. Even the Python scripts or any kind of automation tools that are available, right? In the present world, they are only restricted to one or two applications, right? But using robotic process automation, it is like a process automation. It can have n number of different applications. Again, it is a different application. If you see here, this is a web application. And the second one is Windows or desktop application, right? So similarly, if I have another application like SAP application or mainframe application, there are different types of applications. If we can also integrate those things in the process. It's not like only similar types of applications I will be able to automate. If it is a, when I say process, it can have n number of different types of applications. So all of them constitute together is forming one process, right? So in order to automate this particular automation, we are going for robotic process automation, right? So again, if we see the process automation, right, there are two types of process automations, two types of processes, first of all. So what is a process? Process is nothing but it is a step by step. So from the start till the end, we are defining what each and everything that is there in this particular BPO organization task, correct? So that is a process. So what are the two types of process? We can say one is repetitive process, right? And second is non-repetitive process, right? So there are two processes, which are one is repetitive process and second one is non-repetitive process. So what is the difference between the repetitive and non-repetitive? So if what is this particular process, which it is repetitive or non-repetitive, the BPO organization task?
That's a repetitive.
Yes. So basically, whatever the process that they are doing, if they do today, if they are doing tomorrow or day after tomorrow, even after 1 year, the process remains same. Whatever the flow that they are following, it will not change, right? So when I say repetitive, it is nothing but a rule-based structure, right? It's like, first of all, we have to click this. Second, we have to do this. So it is like completely set of rules driven, right? It is not going to change at any instant of time, right? So these come under repetitive processes, right? So similarly, there are non-repetitive processes. So what can be a non-repetitive process?
Which happens for one time and then...
It changes frequently.
It
cannot happen as a rule-based. So each and every time of his execution, it can change. It's not mandatory that it should change, but if it is changing from first run to second run, if it is differing, right, then it is a non-repetitive task. Okay, let us take two examples to understand repetitive and non-repetitive. So let us say there is a task one. So task one is to fetch the tweets on Sachin Tendulkar. Okay, so this is my first task. Okay, there is similarly, I have another task, which is task two. So in task two, my objective is to fetch positive tweets on Sachin Tendulkar, right? So now tell me which task is, what type of process it is. The first task, okay, or else can you tell me which task is easier to accomplish and which task is a bit difficult? Out of this task one and task two. First task is to fetch tweets on Sachin Tendulkar. Second task is to fetch positive tweets on Sachin Tendulkar.
I mean, task one is straightforward, which don't have logical breakdown. I mean, yes. Either, so task two should be tougher, which needs to pick only the positive ones. So exactly. They need to filter out.
Yes.
Here.
Yes. So if we again come into and divide this into process, this task one comes under repetitive process, right? So task two comes under non-repetitive. Why? Because this task two will change each and every point of time, depends on the positive tweets. When I say positive tweet, when I say normal tweets, right, we can, if we assume there is a database already there, right, I can actually filter based on the Sachin name, whatever name Sachin Tendulkar, I can filter the tweets and then I can get the count, right? So that is possible. But when I say positive tweets, the system will, correct? So let us say somebody has given a tweet like Sachin is a great batsman, right? So the great comes under positive for us, but the system cannot identify that great is a positive, correct? So similarly, if somebody has given a tweet like he's not so great, right? So similarly, the system cannot identify not so great as negative tweet, correct? So this is it cannot be possible. So that is the reason it is a non-repetitive task, and we cannot be able to accomplish this automation 100%. So if let us say we need human intervention. That means one human has to sit there and he has to divide the positive and negative tweets, right? Out of all the tweets, he has to say these are the positive tweets, these are the negative tweets. If that differentiation is done, right, then the system can give the count, right? So that is the reason.
That's why we need the IQs, right? IQ, which applies here.
Yes,
IQ.
Exactly. Yes. So currently, whatever the automations that we are performing using robotic process automation tools, all of them are these categories, which are like all of them are repetitive tasks. we are only focusing on repetitive tasks. We are not focusing on non-repetitive tasks, right?
Okay, yeah.
Whatever tasks we are focusing, it is all repetitive tasks that we are going to automate using robotic process automation. So can I say in that case, this is a disadvantage that we are not able to accomplish this non-repetitive tasks, correct?
Hmm.
So we are having some disadvantage even with the RPA, right? So that is the reason.
Yes.
All the companies, all the tech giants, they are actually building the next version of RPA, which is cognitive RPA. So have you heard about this terminology, cognitive RPA?
Yes, I did. Yeah.
Okay. So when I say cognitive RPA, it's like RPA plus artificial intelligence. So this is the next level wherein actually integrating artificial intelligence with the RPA. So once the cognitive RPA is in active, right, to for like if it is implemented to all the tools, then we will be able to work on these tasks also, which are non-repetitive, right? In that case, we will be able to automate 100% for this non-repetitive task. But at this point of time, using RPA, we are not able to do 100% for the non-repetitive tasks, right? So for non-repetitive tasks, we need human intervention to accomplish the tasks, right? So now, did you understand what is a process automation? So what are the different types of processes, right? So
yes,
the first terminology is process automation. Now we will see what is robotic, right? So let us say we have automated this task. So whatever the task that we are doing, right? This 30 employees are doing. I will automate this particular task, okay? So this task is automated. Right, so it's like it is available in the system, but somebody needs to run it, right?
Hmm.
But again, it's like I cannot go and manually start it and manually end it, right? It's if I'm doing it again, there is no use of automation, correct? So the task has to schedule itself. When I have, if it has to run maybe daily 1 hour or daily 1 hour or daily twice, it has to check some this server status, right? It has to check each and every time, maybe hourly or maybe at least 5 hours once or something. Like there will be predefined schedule that they have to check, correct?
Yeah.
So using this robotic, when I say robot, right? So there is a robot that is available in the this RPA, right? So there is a robot or bot, we call it as a robot or bot, that robot or bot. So it is physically available in the software, whatever the software that we are installing. There are different tools, right? Like Automation Anywhere or Blue Prism. So it is available as a bot there, right? So this particular bot can able to run the automation. So after automating this particular task, right, I will get some output, like I will get a PA1. So this PA1 is the automated version of this entire task, right? So when I wanted to run this PA1, I'm going to assign this PA1 to the bot, right? If I wanted to schedule it, let us say there is a concept called scheduler, right? There is a concept called scheduler. Using scheduler, I'm going to schedule this task, this PA1. Let us say I wanted to run it daily, right? That schedule I'm going to give to the schedule and then assign it to the bot, right? Once I assign it to the bot, then even if I'm not there, even if the employee is not there, the admin is not there, that particular task will automatically trigger and it will run, right? So one more thing is, robot or bot means how many licenses that we are going to purchase. So in this particular RPA tools, right, we are not going to pay for the tool. We are basically paying for the license. All the RPA tools are not open sources. All of them are paid versions, right? Even Automation Anywhere or Blue Prism or UiPath, all of them, like there will be licenses. If you wanted to buy one license, you will pay this some amount. So similarly, if I want to get 2 or 3 more licenses, right? It depends on the number of licenses that we purchase, right? So if I purchase 5 licenses, that means I'm going to get 5 bots in my machine, right? So it depends on how many licenses I am purchasing. The company is purchasing for their use, right? So if they think that the one bot is not sufficient for entire automations to run, right? In that case, they can actually purchase multiple bots, right? So together, when we combine this particular robotic process automation, so it is robot and then process automation. We are actually automating the process automation using robot, right? So that is the reason the total terminology is robotic process automation, right? So now you are clear what is process automation, what are types of processes, and what is robot?
Yes, yes, I am. Yeah.
Okay. So now that we have seen the introduction about robotic process automation, now let us discuss about the advantages and limitations of RPA. Okay. So advantages. So whatever we have discussed till now, so are you seeing any advantages that we are having with RPA?
Yeah, probably the repetitive manual tasks can be handled by a bot without any human intervention, which is error free, and obviously it saves the cost to the company.
Exactly correct. So before automation, I'm using 30 employees here in this particular task. I'm using 30 employees. So let us say after automation, can I remove all the 30 employees? Because the automation in place, it will run itself anyway, right? So these 30 employees cost I'm reducing, correct?
Yes, but more rather than, I mean, what I see here, so it moreover decreases the effort rather than the employee, right? So this is the only task they do whole day, no, right?
No, I'm just giving an example. If let us say this particular BPO organization, if this is the project that they are working on, so all the BPO organizations, mostly whatever the tasks that they do are repetitive, right?
Yeah.
100%, we can say 99 to 100%, we can say all of them are repetitive tasks. In that case, if it is repetitive, right, even if they are doing other tasks or any other tasks, we can able to automate them, correct?
Yes.
So in that case, my question is whether we will be able to remove all the 30 employees, because the automation is in place, we can actually work, we can actually accomplish all the repetitive tasks, correct?
Yeah.
But in real time, what happens is maybe there might be scenarios wherein the bot might fail also, or there might be issues with system or server or we cannot say that it will work 100%. So that is the reason we are actually having support guys. So if you see RPA support, RPA dev, RPA testers,
operators,
there are different roles for RPA. So these RPA support or operator that we are talking about are the guys who are going to support the tool. So currently these employees are supporting this particular task. Now after automation, they are going to support the tool. So they have to make sure the tool is running perfect, correct? So that is the reason we need at least one employee per shift, which is like 3 employees. I'm just giving an example. So before automation, we were using 30 employees. After automation, I am using only 3 employees, correct? So this is one of the major advantages using RPA, correct?
Yes.
Cost savings, right? Cost saving in terms of FTEs, right? So FTE is full-time equivalent.
Yeah.
Right? And then another advantage is AHT, average handling time. So AHT reduction. So when I say average handling time, so let us say one employee is working, taking some 30 minutes or 40 minutes to accomplish this total task. For one time, let us say he is taking 30 minutes. Okay. So when I automate the same task using bot, it is going to take much, much lesser time. It might even finish in 10 minutes or 15 minutes, right? So we are reducing the overall handling time for that particular task, right? Using the robotic process automation. So that is the reason, one of the main advantages average handling time reduction. We are going to reduce the overall handling time that is handled by the particular task. Correct? And as you rightly mentioned, so there are no errors. It's like error free. So let us say when the human is working on the same task, if let us say what he did is, instead of seeing that the status is successful, instead of seeing that the status is failed, he thought it is successful. Right? In that case, he will not report the incident also. Right? So ultimately, it is going to create some escalations or whatever it is. Right? So we can say error free after automation. Right? So there are no human errors. Right?
Yeah.
So once we automate the task, even if we are running for the 100th time or 200th time, as it is a rule-based, right? Rule-based or repetitive, it is going to follow the same processes, same steps that are defined while automating. Correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, other than this, or else, like, are we seeing any other advantages? So the bot is available 24/7, right? So if any instant of time, if I wanted to run the automation, the bot is available. When we compare with the humans, like we will have day offs or sick offs or whatever it is, but the bot is available 24/7, 365 days, right? So anytime we'll be able to perform the automation, right? So these are the advantages that we are having with robotic process automation, correct?
Yes.
So now that we have seen the advantages, what are the disadvantages that we are facing, or limitations that we have with RPA? So I think we have already discussed. If we see here, we are unable to work with non-repetitive tasks at this point of time. Correct?
Yeah.
So that is a limitation for RPA. Right? So which is actually in research, and they are working to develop the cognitive RPA. Correct? So when our cognitive RPA comes into picture, then this particular limitation can be overcome. Right? Okay. So have you heard about a terminology called chatbot?
Yes.
So what is chatbot?
Chatbot is a smart bot which replies to your chats based on the words it will cross check with the database it available and replies accordingly.
Yes, correct. Yeah. Yeah. So basically, in the previously, right, whenever we are let's say there is a company, they have an app or whatever it is, they are providing some service, okay, like booking a flight ticket or whatever it is. Previously, what they used to have is they used to have this customer support. So in that customer support, they can actually email or chat with the agents, right? So previously, humans used to be there and they used to reply and they used to give responses. But almost from 3 to 4 years, these chatbots came into picture. So chatbots are the implementation of RPA, right? So it is the first implementation of RPA is a chatbot, right? So once we implement the chatbot, it's like a system bot. So whatever the bot that is available in RPA, right? The same bot is going to be available in chatbot. So there are different languages like NLP, natural language processing, right? So it's like, first of all, this chatbot is going to understand the human language. So let us say the human is giving some text like, I booked a flight at 8 a.m. today, right? So the system has to understand 8 a.m. is the timing, right? And then today means it has to pick the today's date, right? So this particular human language is converted to machine language, right? Once it is converted to machine language, then the machine language will be understood by the chatbot, right? So once it understood the chatbot, then it will try to understand the query that he is trying to put there, right? Then it will search against a database, right? Whatever the query that he has, his details and everything, it is going to search against the database, and then it is going to give some output, right? Again, it will be in the machine language. That machine language is again converted to human language. Human language is what we get as an output from chatbot. Right? So this is the process that is involved in chatbots. So again, in chatbots, there are two types. One is a normal basic chatbot, and second is artificial intelligence enabled chatbot. Right? So when I say normal chatbot, right, I have to define all the responses, all the questions myself I'm going to define. So I'm going to set the context also. Let us say if it is booking a flight, if I'm trying to ask a question wherein which is out of the context, if I ask some question which is out of the context, which is not at all related to flight, right? In that case, the bot will say, I'm unable to understand whatever you are saying, correct? So this is kind of response that we get from chatbot, right? So these, it's like I'm going to define all the context and I'm going to give all the predefined questions. What is the flight? What are the details? So these are the different sets of questions. I'm randomly, let us say if 100 questions or 1,000 questions, I'm giving it to the chatbot so that the chatbot is ready and prepared to answer the same question when the user is asking. So that is a normal or a basic chatbot. And when I say artificial intelligence enabled chatbot, right? It will be able to understand itself and it will be able to understand. Let us say it is going to update itself every time. Whenever the human is asking a new question, it is going to update itself. It is going to put that question into database and then going to answer that question as well. So that is artificial intelligence enabled chatbot. So have you seen any real time examples of chatbot?
Yes, I do.
So can we give any some examples for real time chatbots?
Yeah, in the current, where I'm working, we use the basic USC support automated. I mean, wherein we can chat saying if you need a desktop support, you say some IT issue there, then it asks what kind of IT issue. Then we chat probably the Outlook is not working. Then it comes up with the Outlook article. I mean, what type of error you say? Yes. Let's type an error. Then it comes back with an article and it will suggest the steps how to do. If that doesn't resolve the issue, then it will ask you to raise a ticket with the form and all stuff.
Exactly, so, correct. Yes. Then, yes. So other than that, Google Assistant, right? Google Assistant is also an example of RPA, right?
Apple Siri.
And then
Bixby and all.
Yeah, Amazon Alexa.
The Bixby, right?
And then have you heard about IBM Watson?
What? I heard, but I haven't tried yet.
IBM Watson. And then Google Dialogflow. So Google Dialogflow is one of the free, out of all of this, Google Dialogflow, this Google Assistant is there, right? Google Assistant is using Google Dialogflow API, right? So Google Dialogflow API is free. So if I wanted to implement the chatbot to my site, right? So I can actually use Google Dialogflow, implement the chatbot to any applications or any websites that we have, right? So these are the real-time examples for chatbots, right?